Okay, I would like to begin with prayer for Brother Candido. Pray that God would anoint his teaching today. But just to let you know, Brother Nolan did forget to bring the projector. He forgot to leave it for one of us to use. So we're kind of trying to figure out exactly what the best way to do this is. So he's going to use his laptop. And he'll... Normally we use a projector that you can see off the wall what the verse we're talking about. But we're just going to have to use the laptop for today. So, God, we pray that you will anoint Brother Candido and that you will help him to teach the class today. I pray that your spirit will move upon each of one of us and that we will receive your word. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good job.
Sister reminded me, Sister Priscilla will be flying back in the morning, right? Yes, she'll be flying home in the morning. So let's pray for safety. Lord, we pray that you will, Sister Priscilla is flying home tomorrow, and I pray that you will give her a safe flight home in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for reminding me about that. Okay, I think we're ready now. I wish we had our projector, and I wish everybody had a Bible, but they don't really. I was all excited until we didn't realize we didn't have the projector, but I think we're just going to go ahead and go on with what we have. Thank you, brother. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Even without the projector, we're praising the Lord anyways.
That's the first thing we had on the projector was praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm. I missed that one.
You can do it. I gotta get it out.
So my title today is The Messenger. The Messenger. So that is my title for today. What?
It's writing.
I'm not sure what this word is here. The Messenger bringing. Like? Yeah, I don't know what that is. I think it's I think it's supposed to say the messenger is proclaiming the Messiah's coming. Let me check this again. Hold on. Proclaiming
the way of the Lord.
Yes, the messenger is proclaiming. John the Baptist was a messenger proclaiming that the way of the Lord is coming. So yes, I believe that's what you're talking. So our title for today is The Messenger. Proclaim, I think that's what he's trying to say. It was the word proclaim.
Proclaim.
So that word is proclaim.
Yes.
Proclaim.
Yeah. The messengers proclaim that the Messiah is coming. Okay, great. Thank you so much, brother. So in John, when I was reading this, if you go back when Jesus was after his ascension, the church was established, and that's when these books were written. That's when John wrote these books. From Matthew, Matthew has a perspective, and if you compare all the different perspectives, it has a good point. So if you look in John chapter 1, verse 13. Don't turn it off. Hold up.
If I miss something, let me know. You know that I... Yeah, you catch it. Because right now,
I'm sorry. Chapter 1, verse 3.
1, verse 3.
Wait. That's not right.
Yes, it is. and without him.
All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And Elisha everything was desolate and barren. I need help. This one is. It's King James Version. John 1, verse 22. Okay. What did you say? Wait. Hold on. I can't get his attention. I am not the voice. So the Lord speaking, he says, I am the voice
of one
crying in the wilderness. But make the way of the Lord. John 1:23. It's in the New Testament. It says it's a fulfillment of John the Baptist himself. He's talking about in Isaiah when he told the story. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And it's John the Baptist himself. He was the one crying out. Make the straight the way of the Lord. And the word Lord right there is Yahweh. And in the old Hebrew language, Yahweh was without vowels. It was pronounced, you didn't say the vowels. But in English, when they did the translations, they had to, they just didn't have vowels in the Hebrew. So it's Yahweh, which is interpreted as Lord, which is the same thing. So that was the ancient Hebrew language at that time. But now we add the vowels, which is actually Yahweh. And YHUH is different, but YHWH is the same as Yahweh. And then in English, when they translated it for the YHWH, they changed it to Lord, which has the same meaning. So, and the Lord is referring to Jesus himself. Jesus is Yahweh. And he is the same. It's the Lord, Jesus, Yahweh is the Lord. And he was saying that he was proclaiming in the wilderness, crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. And he's warning all of them to get ready, make his way straight. And he's referring to Yahweh. And in the Old Testament, he was saying, John the Baptist was telling him, proclaiming that when Jesus was coming, and that was the Yahweh, just as said the prophet Isaiah. He said that he's the voice of one, which was John the Baptist, and he was the one crying out in the wilderness. And he was proclaiming for everybody to prepare the way of the Lord, to make his way straight. And make straight the way of the Lord, which is for the one Lord. There's one God. And he's going to get ready. Be ready and make his way straight. Keep watching. He's coming. The Lord is coming. The Yahweh is coming. And that was Jesus when he came. And in Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. Says, behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord, whom ye will seek, shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. So Malachi, he was proclaiming about the Lord. He was telling everybody that I will send my messenger. The Lord will send his messenger. And it says, behold, I will send my messenger. And this is Yahweh speaking. I will send my messenger. And this was John the Baptist that he was referring to. And he shall prepare the way before me. Notice, so he says me. This is singular. He's speaking of one person, one God. Send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord, whom ye seek, shall suddenly come to his temple. I like the New King James Version reading as well, too, and it says, behold, I will send my captain, my messenger, and he, which is the messenger, he's speaking of my messenger, he will prepare the way before me. I'm Yahweh, this is Yahweh speaking, the Lord whom ye seek. He shall be in his temple, and the messenger, so the messenger is in lowercase, and in a, and then when it's in capital letters, that means he's referring to Jesus, to referring to God, Yahweh. And he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. So this is referring to the Lord of hosts, which is God, and the person, the messenger that's down here is just proclaiming the way of the Lord. So God became flesh, which was manifested in Jesus, but he was still God. And in Matthew chapter 3, verse 3. So in Matthew chapter 3, verse 3 says, for this is he that was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And if you go back in John, the verse in John and the verse in Matthew, they both are speaking of the same thing. They're both saying that when Elias says that God was sending his messenger. And so in John, he was speaking about John the Baptist was the voice of one crying in the wilderness, proclaiming that this is God, this is Yahweh, this is that one that was spoken of. Do you have anything else you want to add to this? No. Without this projector, go ahead, carry on. Do you guys have any questions or anything you want to add? So Elisha, in the Old Testament, Elisha spoke with God, yes. He was a prophet, actually, and he prophesied about what will happen in the future. And he said that the voice of one crying in the wilderness, and he spoke of that one that would be crying in the wilderness. And he said, make his way straight. This is the Messiah, Yahweh, make his way straight. And after Elisha was gone, for like 40 years later, so many years later, it happened, John the Baptist was born. And when John the Baptist began preaching and proclaiming to the people to make his way straight, he made reference to what Elisha said. Which prophet? Elisha.
Elias.
What Elias said.
Oh, it says Isaiah.
Yeah, I know. He was prophesying that this is that Lord that has come to save us. This is that which the prophet Elias has said. And he said, behold, I will send my messenger, and he will proclaim for me, and he will proclaim in the world. And this is God's messenger. It says, behold, I, and this is God speaking himself. It says, if you go back to Malachi and the prophet, when he wrote this down, he was prophesying about what will happen. And Malachi was the last prophet. And there was like 400 years of silence after Malachi. And this, what John the Baptist happened like 400 years later. And he was speaking about the Messiah will be coming. But 400 years later, there was false doctrines that arrived. After 400 years later, if you go back, Mary, when she became pregnant, and Elizabeth, her cousin, Elizabeth. Yeah, and when she became pregnant. When she became pregnant with John the Baptist, and Mary was pregnant with Jesus, when they came close together, John the Baptist got excited in his mother's womb when they came in close proximity together. And it's like he sensed that he was in the presence of Jesus. And he knew who that was. And Mary knew that she had the baby Jesus in her. But Elizabeth could feel John moving rapidly in her womb. And this is proof that this was prophesied long ago. But why was this prophesied? Was this for salvation? It was because God had to come on earth. He had to become flesh. He had to fulfill the prophecy. Can you see this verse here?
Yes.
Yeah, I can see it, actually. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. this agreement, that the promise that they had, this covenant is referring to the promise that they had together. So it's like an agreement, a promise together. So that's what it means by a covenant. And the other word, delight. Delight means they're excited, the delight in. In the way the Lord hosts. So it's like the Lord's up there with the host of angels around him. So when John, when Jesus was born, when they were both born, and as they were growing up, when it was time, John the Baptist began to preach. If you go back to Matthew chapter 3, verse 3, again it says, "For this is he that was spoken by the prophet Esaias." Esaias. Like Elijah, Elias.
Isaiah.
Okay, that's what I was trying. Okay, it's Prophet Isaiah.
Yeah, that's what Prophet Isaiah.
Yeah. For this is that which was spoken by the Prophet Isaiah. So in the King James Version, it says Isaiah, and the right spelling is both different spellings for the same word, for the same name. So, and this is the fulfillment of what was spoken by the prophet. And it's happened. And John the Baptist began to preach, crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way, for the Lord is coming." And he spoke about Yahweh, that this is Yahweh. This is Jehovah. This is him. And there's the Lord. And he became flesh, so that all could see him. And this was that fulfillment that was spoken. And he said, voice of the one crying in the wilderness, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, and make his path straight." And when you're baptized, or when Jesus was baptized,
first they followed John, but John said, "Don't follow me, follow him from hereafter."
And then they began to follow Jesus from that point on. And what an influence on his life. What an influence that he must have had. Wow. Did you know that the part that says make that path straight? It actually means to repent and don't be wishy-washy, but repent and go and follow the Lord and go straight. Ah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I see him. Where's he at? What did he say? You know, John the Baptist was proclaiming everybody to repent and be baptized for repentance. But when Jesus, he said he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And John was proclaiming that there was one coming, and he was telling them that you need to repent of your sins. But then you had to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire later. But there's one coming that will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. So without the blood, we wouldn't have that forgiveness of sins. We need to have his blood. It's his blood that covers us from our sins. And John 1 verse 19 says, I can't find it and look at this. As Jesus was coming to him, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb which was the sacrifice what they used, behold, the Lamb of God. So he was talking to Jesus, and he was calling him the Lamb of God. As John saw him, he was calling Jesus the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. So he knew, when he saw Jesus, he knew that he was the Lamb of God who was here to take away the sins for all of us. And he knew the importance. He understood. And he's like, hey, I am not worthy. And he said, there's one coming that's not, I'm not even worthy to unlatch his shoes. And he was proclaiming that he's coming. And when he came, he introduced him to them. And from that point on, everybody was baptized in Jesus' name. And then they were filled with his spirit and received the Holy Ghost and fire.
Scripture was John 1 and 29.
I'm not, okay, John 1, 29. So he said, that is God, and God became flesh. God didn't leave heavens and become into, and it was only in man, but God was God, and he was also manifested in flesh, but he was the same God. He was God's everywhere at once, but he was also in Jesus. And John recognized that he was the Lamb of that for our sacrifice, for our sins. And he said, what verse is this? I'm lost. They baptized with
really,
and he knew water. Not, but oh, there was one manifest with Israel, wherefore I come baptizing with water. And John bear record. I need to know what verse is on. There it is. And I knew not, and said unto me, baptized with water, the same upon me, upon whom shalt thou see the Spirit descending and remain upon him, the same is he which baptized with the Holy Ghost. No, I'm lost. Let's see if you can find a verse. So the Spirit descended upon him. So when Mary conceived, that was God inside her, and he conceived. There was no separation, and he had the same anointing. And in verse 33.
Yeah, I got it. It's John 1:33.
So, and I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize him with water. The same said unto me, upon whom shalt thou see and the Spirit descending? So you can't see the Spirit. He had to be manifested in the flesh to be able to see who God was. So God himself is a spirit, and no man can see him. And the only way you can see God is through this, is through the Son. And the Spirit, and that's Jesus, when he became flesh, you could see God at that point. Do you guys have any questions? Oh, going back to the word covenant. Covenant means like, in the Old Testament, they had to make an agreement, like there's a promise, there was the covenant with Abraham for the promised land, and there was another covenant that the children of Israel were my people, and that they would follow him, that they would follow his way and offer up their sacrifices. And then the Lord still makes his covenant with the temple. It says, you are my temple now. And we have a covenant with him that we need to follow his ways. And when Jesus died, and remember that there was a great earthquake in the temple, and that veil was rent. But then on the third day, he rose again. And now each and every one of us are now the temple of God. And so we enter into that covenant with him. when we receive the Holy Ghost, our bodies become that temple. So, and you are, when you're filled with the Holy Ghost, you are, God's Spirit's in you, and you become the temple of the Holy Ghost, the temple of God. Okay, so I understand that, but for the sign covenant, I didn't understand the sign that you used. So that actual sign, that actual word was covenant. So that's the word, that's the sign that we use for a covenant, which is like a promise. When we make an agreement together, we sign a contract together. And it's kind of like God's way of making it, signing a contract together, kind of like. So it's more so my sign that I use. There's a sign for salvation, but this also can be freedom. It could be independence. It can have several different meanings. Independence, freedom, redemption. It's just I initialize it so I know exactly which word that we're using, because they can have several different meanings for the same sign. So that was why I added that. See, I know it's a little bit C-sign, but it just makes it easier for me to know which word I'm using, so I can actually make it more clear. Oh, okay. Thank you. Yeah, I like that. I like how you set that up. That was good. Cool. So when you see that, it's the word covenant means it's a promise from God with you. There's a lot. The word covenant's in the Bible many times. I have one more thing that just came to my mind. When Jesus came, it goes back to the prophecies, and it lines up with everything that the prophets had spoken. And he made a covenant, and when the Lord came, it lines up exactly with the Old Testament prophecies. And this is the fulfillment when Jesus came. It was when John the Baptist prophesied. It was a fulfillment of what was spoken way back in the Old Testament. So this is, the Word of God is so clear. And when His Holy Ghost comes, when the Holy Ghost overshadowed Mary and she became pregnant and Jesus was born, it was God manifested in the flesh. So I've missed Matthew chapter 3, verse 17. It said, Matthew 3, verse 17 says, "And behold, there was a voice in heaven that saith, Behold, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And what does that mean right there? And this is not, how would the Trinitarians explain this? They would say, when John baptized Jesus, there was a dove that ascended, and it was like a symbol of the Holy Ghost. That dove was a symbol of the Holy Ghost, really. And they heard a voice from heaven. They heard a voice, and it said, this is, referring to Jesus, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Does that mean that they're separate, Jesus and God? Is there any separation between the two? He said that was his son, and they heard a voice. Does that mean that there's a separation? How would you explain that to a Trinitarian person? What did you say? Don't believe in what? Okay, do you mind saying that again over here? Okay, so I would explain that the word omnipresent. Mm-hmm. That means that is everywhere at the same time. Jesus is everywhere at the same time. Jesus is here. Jesus is in the other room. Jesus is in heaven. Jesus is in another country, all at the same time. He is everywhere at once. Trinitarians don't believe in the word omnipresent, or the Trinitarians don't understand what that word really means. That means Jesus is everywhere. They don't believe that. they believe that there are separate persons, and they don't believe in the word omnipresent. For example, Moses, when he traveled up to the Mount Sinai, he saw a burning bush, or when he was doing his travels, he saw a burning bush. But the bush wasn't being consumed. It should have just, been completely burned out, but it wasn't. And when he got closer to that burning bush, he heard a voice crying out from the bush. And the voice told him to take off his shoes. And he spoke with this burning bush. And God was in that burning bush, which means God is in the air, or God is still here. God is everywhere. Like for an example, right now, when Moses melted in the mountain, and he spoke with God up on the mountain, was God here at the same time? Yes, God is here at the same time, just as well. While God was speaking with him up in the mount, God was speaking with Moses up in the mountain, and God was here at the same time. So when John saw Jesus coming, or when John saw that, when after he had baptized Jesus, he saw that dove, that symbol of that dove, and he heard that voice that said, so it's still God, but God was in Jesus as well at the same time. So Jesus was a man, but he was God also. And there's no separation between the two. So the dove was just a symbol. So in, like, symbolizing like the, like for me, when I got the Holy Ghost, and each of you, when we get the Holy Ghost, that Holy Ghost is in me, and that Holy Ghost is in each and every one of you. And it follows you where you go, where you go home. And you still have that Holy Ghost with you. And it's inside you. And that's still God. God is living inside of us. God is living. Oh, God was in Jesus, but he was still fully God out too, as well. So you know the Trinitarians believe that there are three separate persons. So which do you prefer to come and to dwell inside of us? Do we pick which one we want? Do we pick the Father to live with us and then decide now we want to have the Son live inside of us? I mean, can we do that? So if we believe that there are three separate entities in heaven, three separate gods, or three separate... So do we want to have... Maybe we want to have the Father living in us, and we decide, no, let's go ahead and try to have the Son. What do you do? So Peter, in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Peter said, repent and be baptized in Jesus' name for remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So who's the Holy Ghost? It's a gift, but who's the Holy Ghost? It's Jesus. It's God. So he said, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, but who's God? Who's the Father? There's no separation between them. When you receive that Holy Ghost, that love, you're receiving that one God. Mm-hmm. I used to think there was Trinitarian before. I used to pray for, to all, and then I went out and went in the world, and I felt guilty, and I came to the truth, and I realized that I needed to be baptized in Jesus' name. There was one God at. So I needed God's Spirit, not my flesh, but it was his blood that he gave that provided a remission of sins. And it is so important that we receive this revelation. Amen. Amen. Okay, so you say that God is here. And you all pray, right? And we all pray, and we're all in the world praying. And God hears all of us praying at the same time. That is correct. She said God is here, but God is also inside the church. But God is hears each and every one of us when we pray. And that's right. That's beautiful. I know some of you might not have been baptized in Jesus' name, and I encourage you, you need to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. It's for the remission of our sins, and it's important. If you don't want to, if you're not baptized, how are you going to get remission of sins? If you're not born again of the water and of the Spirit, you cannot, and you can't even see the kingdom of God. You cannot go in. You just can't even see it. You can't go in. You must be born again of the water. And how do you be born again of the water? Through baptism. That is correct. And being born again of the water is through baptism. And be born again of the Spirit is what? And that's when you receive the Holy Ghost. So when you're born again of the water, that's when you take His name upon you. And you're born, you're baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of all of your sins. And then the Spirit, which is God's Spirit, He will pour out His Spirit on you. And He says, I will send my Father. No. Yeah, it says, the Holy Ghost, call out on my name. If you tell Jesus you want the Holy Ghost, you will receive it. So if any of you have not been born again, you're not connected with Him. You're not one of His. And I love all of you, and I encourage you. We need to be born again. We need to know. I mean, you never know what's going to happen tomorrow. It is so important to be born again. So in John chapter 3, verse 36. It says he, and this is anybody that's just referring to, it could be a man or a woman. It says he who believeth in the Father. Oh, in the Son. Wait. He that believes in the Son has everlasting life. So if you believe the Son, and you're going to have everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see heaven, shall not even see life, shall not see heaven. And they'll be lost. And that's what the word says. But the wrath of God abideth in him. Abideth on him. So if you don't believe in this, in the God's the Son, let's see, John. Let's read the verse again. It says he, which is referring to anybody. It could be a man or woman. It's anybody in general. He that believeth on the Son. The Son. And it's important to believe on the Son. You have to believe on Him. The Son of God. You have to believe on Him. He that believeth on Him hath everlasting life. But he that believeth not in him, but he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life. Which this word life here is kind of referring to the afterlife. So there's two deaths. You have. And our second life would be like, we go to heaven. But the wrath of God abideth on him. So if you believe on us, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And another verse says this, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. So it's really important. The son, we need the son for salvation. We need that, the blood, that sacrifice. Remember in the Old Testament, we had to do sacrifices every year. They had to kill an animal, and they had to offer up his blood for a sacrifice. And that was to push back our sins for one more year. And each year they had to do that sacrifice. And Jesus, when he was beaten and he died and was raised, rose again from the dead, he became that ultimate sacrifice for us. So once in a while, we like to inform people about Sunday. That Brother Canito will teach, or I'll teach. Sometimes when Brother Nolan is gone, we'll still have class. And if you love the Word of God, and you love God, and you still show up every Sunday, regardless of whether Brother Nolan's here or not, and we still have deaf class, so, and I know that we all love Brother Nolan. I know we love his teaching. But when he's gone, we don't skip out on church. We still need the Word of God. We still need to hear the teaching. So if you hear that there's no deaf class, and that they're just be assured, there's still church. We still have church in the Sunday school, and we'll have deaf class here. Because we love God, and we want to have more. This is God's church, right? It's important that we see the Word of God. So when Brother Nolan's gone, or Brother Bishop Wilson's gone, or Pastor's gone, they have other preachers that come and preach for the church here. So for with us in the ASL, I mean, if Brother Nolan's gone, then Candido could do it. If Candido's not, and you know, we'll do it. We support each other, and anointing is upon him. Anointing is on Brother Nolan. And it's very beneficial to receive the Word of God. I love all of you guys, and I want all of us to be connected with God. Amen. And teach us to grow more in you and to trust in you more. And Brother Nolan's God, we don't want to be just kind of like wandering astray and not knowing what to do. We need to continue, motivate ourselves, continue reading the Word of God, continue studying it, continue coming to church and receiving the Word of God. And if Brother Nolan, he loves to teach, and he's devoted his life to that. And if he was to move away, we're still in this church, and we still could hear the preaching and the Word of God in the church, and that's and we need that. So if Jeff was to move away, I would still stay here and be in church. I would just sit in the church and listen to the Word of God. It would be a challenge myself to continue, keep coming. I love God. I love His Word. But we're here to follow the Word of God and to get the Word of God for ourselves. So, yeah, and we learn with the interpreters as well, which is great. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word that was shared today. And I pray that you will help us understand it. And I pray that... thank you, Brother Candido, teaching the Word of God and helping us to understand your word. And you're such an amazing God, awesome God. And we thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen.